Poor People's March. And quite honestly, it was a struggle because not everybody understood the importance of all of us coming together, regardless of the color of your skin. And so there were some leaders that came in from throughout the country to meet with the new leadership of the Poor People's March to stress the fact that we needed to be inclusive of all those that were suffering from the pains of poverty. And I remember going to one of the meetings because I was a body staff and a gentleman from California came and said that I needed to be there. And it was a moving experience, you know, to watch this collective group. Not always agreeing, by the way. There was not universal agreement on all things, but there was agreement on the thing we had in common. And that was that we needed to work for the least among us, that we had a cause to try to eradicate poverty. That was our goal. And yes, there were struggles in how we were going to do that and in the process. But there was this coming together. And by the way, that was the first time I've ever had eyes on my future husband during that time, so it was very meaningful to me. He was the head of the Poor People's March from Texas to Washington, D.C. And later, when I heard him sing with Coretta Scott King, he was a young Mexican-American and a guitar player singer. And when I heard him sing with Coretta Scott King at the Washington Monument, you know what happened. You know, I still like his singing. Married and divorced him twice. Right to continue their education so they can called assets. But what that bill does is say that children who have been here from 3 to 5 years, I don't know whether it's 3 years now or 5 years, and we don't know how long it's going to be because until the bill passes, or, you know, that those children who graduate from Colorado high schools ought to be able to get in-state tuition. And when you stop to think about it, it only makes sense. First of all, our colleges are not filled. They wouldn't be displacing anyone. They would be adding to the coffers by paying in-state tuition. And now they are not allowed to do that. But if we invested 3 to 5 years of education in them already, we will lose that investment, especially of those that are so bright, unless they can go on to college. So it only makes sense for all of us that we continue to invest in the children, that our neighbors are people that we know, and allow them to develop their skills to the greatest degree possible in order to give back to our community. That's what comprehensive immigration reform would help us do. And there's much more beyond that. And I brought with me a pamphlet. I sat on a blue ribbon committee for the EU, for an EU panel on immigration reform. It's called The Architect for Immigration Reform, Fitting Pieces of Public Policy. Now, this panel included folks, there was a joke about it, included different political perspectives, ranging from Polly Baca to Peter Forrest. So you know that we had all different points of view. I brought enough for you. And I think we left them on the back table, is that correct? That we left them on, I know that they're in the back over there. So you can pick up one of these on your way out if you'd like to. What it has, it has some recommendations because we can achieve. You know, if goodwill people come together, and if we, you know, if we sit down, as we would love to see our legislators in Congress sit down and talk about what's the best thing for our country, you can't reach a compromise. Now, quite frankly, you know, I wish we could always have the whole idea. You know, I would love to see everything happen all at one time. But in my decades of working in public policy, what I've learned is it's all in your mouth. You take a step at a time. So I will admit to you, as I did to the Denver Post editorial board, when we went to talk to them about this report, there were four of us that asked me to go and speak to the editorial board. And I said to them, you know, I didn't get everything I wanted. You know, there are some things here that were left out. But it's a step forward. And so I do endorse the recommendations in this report because it's about progress. It's about moving forward. It's about, you know, taking that next step. And it's about taking a bite out of the apple every time you can. And this is another bite out of the apple if we could get Congress to consider this. At any rate, I brought that as a gift for each of you that are really interested in this subject. Because I truly believe, given Martin Luther King's history, his passion, his commitment, he would be here today, urging all of us to be part of this, of obtaining comprehensive immigration reform. And let me just close with a few words that I would like to challenge you to think about. And it's from Martin Luther King's speech at the Riverside Church in 1967. And he said, "We must move past the indecision to action. Now let us rededicate ourselves to the long and bitter, but beautiful struggle for a new world. Shall we say the odds are too great? Shall we say the struggle is too hard? Will our message be that the forces of American life militate against our arrival as full men and women?